In this video, the objective of this presentation is to develop a transfer function of a DC motor now with load. So if it would be better if we make a bit of a reminder, recall how does a transfer function of a DC motor alone looks like, right? So imagine if we have, if you want to go back into transfer function of a single motor, DC motor without no load, it would be, imagine if it is a motor that transform an electrical energy where you supply a voltage of UAT, and in mechanical shaft you get theta MT, the rotational speed of the shaft of the motor. The transfer function looks like, let's say, the transfer function that we call GS, which is observation of the shaft of the motor, the displaced angular displacement of it, over an input of voltage UAS. It is equal to what? It is equal to 1 over, so please look back into the, for the development of this transfer function, please look back into the video of the transfer function of DC motor alone, which is the previous video on which I will put the link in the description below. So it is equal to 1 over RA over T multiplied by S square JM plus RA over T S DM plus S KB, right? So this is a transfer function of DC motor alone. So what are these parameters? So in these parameters, you have in it several things that you have to know. For example, J. So here we have JM. JM is basically the inertia of the shaft of the motor, right? Because the motor have a shaft that it rotates, that inertia have that shaft have a certain inertia, so it is called JM. And then DM, what is DM? DM is basically the friction that we found between the shaft of the rotor of the motor with the bearing, friction of the bearing and rotor. And then there is other parameters. RA is the resistance of the electrical circuit. And then we have KT and KB. So the KT and KB have to be calculated from an operating area graph that comes from a data sheet of a DC motor, right? So how to calculate that KB and KT? KB is basically equals to EA, so the voltage that we feed to the motor, divided by omega no load, and KT equals to stall torque, T stall, multiplied by EA over RA. So the definition of the parameter EA, RA, EA, T stall, and omega no load is as such. If you have a graph that you found in the data sheet, which is the graph of torque of the motor versus the speed of the motor at a certain voltage EA, you'll find omega no load here in the graph. So this is the value that you have to take, and you will find T stall, which is the torque at speed zero here. So this is the value they have to take to calculate KB and KT. And of course, the speed, you have to make it in the SI unit, which is radian per second, and the torque in Newton meters. So that's a recap on transfer function of DC motor alone. So in this particular video, what we're going to look at is what happened is you won't have a motor alone, right? You have your motor in reality, your motor, you will use it to rotate a certain load. So you have your DC motor over here. You will always have a voltage that you are controlling, the voltage you put as input. And then on the output, you'll connect it to a certain load. So at the output, it will produce a certain torque, TMT, so torque motor, and it will rotate at an angular speed or an angular displacement of theta M, theta motor T, and it will be connected to a certain load. So the load that you have learned until now is basically a gear train that is connected to a certain inertia, to a certain damper and friction. So let's say we have a gear train connected to an inertial load. I call it JL because it's J, the inertia of the load. And then let's say we'll have, it is just a shaft and mounted on a bearing. So we have DL. You could have a spring as well, but for the sake of just an example, I'll put JL and DL alone. So let's say the gear train has a number of gears N1 and N2. So when you have a gearing, you know that you transform TM into TL. So TL is the torque load. And we also have a rotational speed at the load with a displacement angle of theta L, T. Right? So this part is basically the load. And this part, the thing that you have here is basically the motor. So now, what do we do? The question is now, what if I want to find the transfer function? G. Now, I'll call it another function as G2S. I want to observe the displacement of the shaft of the motor due to the an input voltage of the motor, but now with load. Just now it is a transfer function without load. Now we have a load. So we know this is just an application of the course that we have learned before on impedance transfer. So what we need to do now is basically to transfer all the impedance that we have on the load into the shaft of the motor, right? So what you need to do is to transfer the impedance. Transfer the impedance on the load shaft to the motor shaft. So if we go back to the transfer function of motor, we know that it is equals to this transfer function. But now instead of having an impedance just JM and DM, also here there is no K, JM is not JM anymore, but it will be a certain equivalent J, which includes the J, the inertia of the shaft of the rotor, but as well as the inertia of the shaft in the second shaft, the inertia of the load in the second shaft, right? So let's write the transfer function together. So it will be equals to, it will be the same form, no change at all, right? So it's 1 over, it's still Ra over Kt, multiplied by S square. Now it's not Jm, it's Je, J equivalent, plus Ra over Kt. Same here, it's S De instead of Dm. There's no K, so the last term is just S multiplied by KB, which is the electrical coefficient, the coefficient of EMF. And now what we need to do is to find what are the value of JE and DE, right? So if we apply the principle of impedance transfer from one shaft to another shaft, JE, we want to look at we want to put all the load on the load of the motor. It's on theta M. So JE on shaft of the motor, that there will be the inertia of the motor, Jm, plus we will have to transfer JL into the shaft M, the shaft motor. So JL, it will be JL multiplied by a coefficient, which is N. Which N is it? Is the N of the destination, which is N1, over N of the origin shaft, N2 square, right? So now it's JE is equal to inertia of the motor JM plus inertia of the load JL multiplied by N1 over N2 square. So the same thing for DE. DE equals to D of the motor, right, plus DL, but multiplied by a coefficient of N1 over N2, the coefficient of impedance transfer square. So now the transfer function is just the same, but instead of having just JM, you have JE, and you have to do the calculation of JE. Okay, so that's the transfer function. That's the answer for, so that's the final answer for the transfer function of G2, which is theta M over UA. The next question that we might ask ourselves is, what if I want to write another transfer function, which is G3S? I don't want to observe the displacement of shaft of the motor. I want to observe the displacement on the shaft of the load. So let's say if I want to observe theta LS over UAS. So how do you find this third transfer function? So I'll let you try. You can pause and try to think about it. And so basically, how do we do it? The way to do it, it's easy, is by applying the transfer function on gearings. So this to do this, what we need to do is to recall the main important relation equation in gearings. In gearings, if I put here, we know that we have in the transfer function between the speed and the torque, we have in speed theta 2 over theta 1 is equals to N2. It's N1 over N2, right? Yeah, it's N1 over N2 equals T1 over T2. So there is two transfer function. Transfer function in terms of torque in gearing, transfer function in terms of speed. So in speed, theta 2 over theta 1 is N1 over N2. And in torque, torque 1 over torque 2 equals to N1 over N2. Okay, so now we know that theta L, so theta L is basically equals to theta 2, is the output shaft. So theta L over theta M, the input shaft, equals to now, so L is the output, M is the input. So if in equivalent to this equation, L is basically theta 2, M is theta 1, so it's equal to N1 over N2, right? So theta L over theta M is N1 over N2. So by doing so, we know that theta L is actually theta M multiplied by N1 over N2, right? So G3S, what G3S is actually, it's theta M multiplied by N1 over N2. So theta M over UAS multiplied by N1 over N2. So now we know what theta M over UAS is. It is basically theta M over UAS. We can find it here. It is basically G2S. So it is equal to G2S multiplied by N1 over N2. So therefore, the final transfer function of theta m over ua. It is the same transfer function as g2. It's just that what we need to do, we need to multiply it by the gearing ratio, n1 over n2, multiplied by 1 over, so it's the same thing, Ra over kt s square je, right? It's je, it's not jm, plus Ra over kt s dm, plus s kb, with, of course, je and de equals to the thing that we have calculated before. It is jm plus jl n1 over n2 square, and the same for de is dm plus dl n1 over n2 square. So this is a transfer function of g3, which is the observation of theta l in function of the input voltage ua. So that's all about transfer function of electric motor with load. So now what we have learned, in order to recap, in rotational part, we have learned pretty much everything from just a rotating shaft alone without no gearing. And in second part, we've learned it with gearing. And then we have also learned how to transport impedance from one shaft to another shaft. And now we have integrated an actuator to the system. So you have a complete system where you supply a voltage, you rotate the motor, and the motor rotates the load. And now you have a complete transfer function where we can, after this, in the coming chapter, what we can do is we can analyze the system. We can simulate the system and try to study its stability, its time response, and its frequential response of a complete system like this. Okay, that's all in this video. See you in the next video. Thank you very much.